Stanford University.
So how's everyone doing today? So just to recap the past 2 weeks, we've been looking at starting off on the right foot, finding the right problem and solutions, as well as seed funding your startup. Today it's a real pleasure to have Gary from Morganthaler Ventures come today and talk about iterating your product and market strategy.
Hey, Gary Morganthaler is a partner at Morganthaler Ventures, where he focuses on information technology and artificial intelligence. He's a past director at Siri, which was acquired by Apple, and a director at Bluearc, which was acquired by Hitachi. Gary started out his career as an entrepreneur and is a self-taught programmer. He then co-founded and led Ilustrian Information Technologies and Ingress Corporation. He received his Bachelor's of Arts from Harvard, where he took courses from Henry Kissinger, and he used to play drums in a rock and roll band.
Gary, thanks so much.
It's great to be with you all, and actually that last claim is my real claim to fame here at Stanford, because in the back when dinosaurs roamed the earth in the 1970s, we were the Stanford party band for about a decade. But those days are gone. So let's see, how do I get to? All right. So thank you all for coming. It's great to be with you. I see some folks that I recognize and I've seen in other venues. And Tom, thank you always for your sponsorship of entrepreneurship here at Stanford. The topic today is iterating product and market strategy. And I wanted to set the stage to say that it's fine to iterate, but you really need to start with something. You need to iterate from something. So let's talk about what constitutes a viable product market strategy, at least as seen by a venture capitalist. Morganthaler Ventures has funded 350 startups over 40 years. And of those, we've scores that have gone public and many more that have been acquired. And we have some claim to experience on this topic. So first, I think it's important to talk about the realities. And the realities are that the odds are against entrepreneurship. How much are they against entrepreneurship? Well, angel investors fund about 60,000 startups every year. Of those 60,000 startups, the venture capital community funds between 600 and 1,000 in a typical year. So your odds of getting funded by a venture capitalist are on the order of 1%. Now, here in Silicon Valley, it's better than that, and they're more venture capitalists, and they're better entrepreneurs, but still the odds are not all that much in your favor. Secondly, if the venture capitalists fund you, then 1 in 10 venture capital portfolio companies achieves about a 10 times return against invested capital. So your odds are then really about 1 in 1,000 of achieving a 10 times return against the capital that is invested behind you and creating an entrepreneurial success. If you look across venture capital portfolios, it's really the category winners. It's the Twitters and the Amazons and Googles and Facebooks and the like that really drive the returns of the venture capital industry. And there, it's about one portfolio in 10 that really has a $1 billion or multi-billion dollar outcome in the portfolio. There are other good returns in the industry, but the real outsized winners are those 1 in 10 portfolios. So when you run the numbers, the odds of creating a multi-billion dollar company from startup are sort of 1 in 10,000 or worse. Is this right, David? Would you agree?
It feels that way.
On a good day, it feels that way, yeah. So for David's firm and for ours, hopefully the odds are better. But for you, I'm sure, you know, the Stanford's already in the top 1/10 or 1/100th of 1%, so your odds are great. But what I want to impress upon you is how difficult it is, how much the odds are stacked against you, and how important it is to think through the process of innovation and to get it right in terms of product market strategy, and once you have it right, to iterate toward success and toward a goal. So the incumbents have a huge advantage over newcomers in an industry, and this is just a list of, I think, 22 different ways that incumbents can beat you. They can beat you with advertising and capital. They can beat you with the cost of their resources. They can beat you with consumer loyalty, with customer investment in their products, many, many ways to beat you. And you have only innovation and your entrepreneurial agility. Happily, that's enough. It's enough because the incumbents, they can innovate too. There's nothing that stops them from innovation. But there's a classic book, and you've probably, how many of you have read The Innovator's Dilemma? Okay, all right, well, good. About half. So Innovator's Dilemma says that innovation within large companies happens, but it's sustaining innovation. It's not disruptive innovation. Why is that? Well, they're listening. They're very good at listening to their customers. They're very good at providing what their customers want. So let's see. There we go. So sustaining innovation, they're very good at listening to their customers, very good at providing what their customers want, but their customers want incremental features. They want incremental additions to the product value and functionality they already have. They're not looking for the new thing because they don't really know it. They're trying to solve their business problems with the tools that they have, and they just need a slightly better tool. So the large companies are good at providing that slightly better tool, and the disruptive innovations start small, and they start in corners of the industry. But that's where entrepreneurship comes in. That's why entrepreneurs can and, with some regularity, do win. So technologies follow an S-curve. They start with low penetration in the market and low relative value added. Over time, they increase in penetration until they have reached the technology potential of a given technology. This is true independent of technology, independent of market. It's really quite a fundamental reality of any technology has a potential both in terms of its utility and in terms of its market adoption. Technology, however, comes in waves. And as one technology matures, oftentimes another technology arises to first take a share of the market and eventually displace it in the market. So successive, these are called S-curves. And this was done by a colleague of mine, Richard Foster, back in the 1970s. It was a new idea back then, believe it or not. So these technology waves appear periodically in the market. And when they do, they start in sort of small corners of the market, but eventually they grow to displace the leaders in the marketplace. These constitute market disruptions, and the disruptors are the ones who really see things differently. You know, Apple Computer under Steve Jobs had a famous advertising campaign called Think Different. And those disruptive entrepreneurs see the world differently. They see what it can be, and they bring a passion around this new technology, the new product architecture, the product vision, or the market vision and the customer value proposition vision. So what does it take then to disrupt a market? So classically, it takes 10x. It takes 10x faster. It takes 10x smaller, 10x lower power consumption, or 10x cheaper. Usually 3x cheaper will do, by the way, but you'd like 10x. The good news for all of us here in Silicon Valley is that Moore's Law has reliably delivered 10x for the last 40 years in five-year chunks. So Moore's Law doubles the density of integrated circuits every 18 months over a five-year period. That actually constitutes 3.5 doubling. So you get basically a 10x every 5 years, like clockwork, coming out of Moore's Law. So that says you have the potential for technology disruption every 5 years. And in fact, if you look back across the last 40 years, that's exactly what we've seen across the industry. So wave upon wave of technology introductions. Mainframes went to mini computers went to PCs, PCs went to client server went to internet, internet went to, cloud and online, online went to mobile. So all of these are just successive waves were enabled by Moore's Law. The good news is that Moore's Law has at least two disruptions to go. So for the next 10 years, the smaller, faster, cheaper paradigm is going to continue to work because photolithography will continue to shrink circuits reliably twofold every 18 months between now and the year 2022. At that point, we hit a wall of physics. And you know that's very hard to negotiate a wall of physics, as I'm sure you know. So either we move to three-dimensional integrated circuits or Moore's Law, at the very best case, slows and conceivably stops altogether. But for the next 10 years, the joyride continues, and it's going to be an interesting time. It's hard, frankly, to predict what those disruptions will be, other than to say they're coming, and they're coming like clockwork. You can just predict it. And the entrepreneurs are the ones who will see what those, you know, disruptions will be, and they will be the ones that take advantage of it. So along with Moore's Law, the internet has created connectivity of everything and the ability to access content, to enable e-commerce, to deliver services, to enable mobile, local, and social connectivity. And it has, in the course of this, it's supplanted traditional media, newspapers, telephones, radio, and soon television. And I think it's a safe bet to say that the Internet of Everything, with 50 billion interconnected devices, will be here with virtual certainty by the year 2020. So that's a huge change in the way our lives will be lived, and in the way that we'll daily interact with the devices that we use, the people that we connect with, and the ways that we do our business and live our lives. So this is coming, and along with Moore's Law and the internet, for the next 10 to 20 years. Yes, please. To enable it? So there are people who are selling these little computers. You've probably seen Raspberry Pi for $35, and the price, of course, will go down. So it's an entire computer on a circuit board that's, you know, half a pack of cigarettes in size, and relatively inexpensive. But that's still too expensive for some applications, so the cost will come down. The connectivity and the internet connectivity is modest at this point, and that will improve. The range is modest. That will improve. The programmability is modest, and the tools are modest. Those will improve. So it's that class of computer connectivity, cost, and the total tool solution that will enable placing this in your, you know, in your it's already in your TV, in your washer, dryer, in your refrigerator. The Internet of Cars is already happening, and it will be, you know, this is definitely coming. Mobile devices were already connected, but really all the appliances in your home, anything that has electronics in it, will be connected to the internet over time. So it's definitely coming, and it's going to be very exciting, and I think it will change the way that we interact with the world. It will make our lives easier in many ways and more complicated in others. And mine just got complicated, so. Okay, there we go. Thank you. Tech support, it's great. Wish we had it at the office. Okay. So for the next 10 to 20 years, these are coming. So how does Stanford deal with innovation? Well, Stanford's probably the most, I mean, it is certainly among and arguably the most innovative university environment in the country and arguably the world. And Stanford sees the stovepipes of academic research and is trying to break them down to create the synthesis of different disciplines within Stanford. And I'm quite impressed with this, and I'm quite convinced that new things will emerge from it. So information technology and genomics is already happening. Information technology and biology in general, the Bluearc campus at Stanford is well along the way of creating massive new innovations that will really change the world. How does Silicon Valley deal with entrepreneurship? I'm going to argue to you that Silicon Valley is indeed the epicenter of entrepreneurship. And I think in society, you get what you celebrate. Wall Street celebrates masters of the universe with financial services, managing, having big houses out on Long Island in the Hamptons, and securitizing everything to our collective detriment. Hollywood celebrates a celebrity. And so I think in society you get what you celebrate, but Silicon Valley uniquely, I think, celebrates entrepreneurship. So elsewhere in the country, big business is celebrated, and the people who are the local heroes are the big business heroes. It's not true here. The people who are celebrated are the entrepreneurs. And they also happen to be the wealthiest, and they happen to be the youngest, and they happen to be the ones who really saw the world differently, jumped from fishbowl to fishbowl, had the idea that was the disruptive innovation, took the risk, built the team, filled out the vision and made it happen. And I think they're the ones who actually deserve, you know, they are the highest status people in Silicon Valley, and that's the way it should be. That's who we are. So getting to iterating your product and market strategy, we've said you have to start with a disruptive innovation. By the way, you should choose a billion-dollar market. It's so hard to build a company anyway, we might as well think big, right? And besides, if you choose a small market and you win, well, what's the point, right? How has this changed the world? How has it really created value? How has it changed your life or anybody else's? So when you think about disruption, think about, you know, how you could really do something important and make a difference. And then once you've chosen that, start with a very narrowly focused target and goal. Choose a customer set, choose a value proposition, and focus. Pick those customers that you want to serve. And I'm a big fan of the Colin Powell doctrine, which is the doctrine of overwhelming force. If you have to go into battle with three times as much, you know, men. Tim, you can speak to this, right? Tim has lived this, actually, quite commendably so. So if you have to go in battle, you know, have three times as much of everything as the other guy, because you really would like to win, and three times is pretty much enough to get you there. So choose, you know, focus narrowly, and then over-resource what you're trying to do, and then just take, you know, take the turf one customer at a time. And then the next part is crossing the chasm. So for those of you who had nothing better to do than read my biography, oh my God, I'm so embarrassed about that. Mine was one of the companies profiled in that Crossing the Chasm book. So a company called Ingress way back when was where this idea was developed. And we took, the author, Jeffrey Moore, took a look at how adoption patterns were happening in the market. And he said, look, there are 2% of the early, of the customers, or really early adopters, they love new technology, they just jump on it. So that, well, the technological pioneers or innovators. And then there's the mass of early adopters, probably the first 15% overall. And after that, you're into the early majority, late majority, and the laggards. And this is independent of markets, but you move from those people who are technology savvy into the early and late majority, which are really market-driven. They're looking for solutions. They're not looking for technologies. And so your product strategy has to mirror being a better technology solution, if you will, to the early innovators and early adopters, and after that being a better whole solution to customers later on. Don't expect that the competitors are going to sit idly. One of my favorite quotes is that from General Helmut von Moltke. Do you all know General? Everybody know General Helmut von Moltke? German general, 19th century. Basically said, no plan, no battle plan survives contact with the enemy. More recently, this has been updated by Michael Tyson, who says, everybody has a plan, and then I punch them, right? Everybody has a plan until they get punched in the face. So that's, you know, that's what, in the market, that's what you got to expect. The competitors are not going to let you take their customers away. They're going to throw up smoke and dust in the air, and you're just going to have to fight, you know, customer by customer for market share as you go along. So what about innovation then? Where does innovation happen? If you take a look at the value chain of a company, starting with R&D, engineering, product design, manufacturing, marketing, distribution, sales, and retail, well, it happens everywhere along the chain. But it happens mostly in product design and in distribution. Those are the places where you actually create the most customer value and you make the greatest difference to the customers. So efficient distribution shaves cost out of interacting with customers. We'll talk about how the internet does that in a minute. And product design innovation builds value, builds customer value, finds solutions for customers. So that's the place to look if you're looking to iterate your product and market strategy. Say, okay, I want to think about how do I collapse distribution and how do I build the product in such a way as I create more customer value. So when you're engineering customer value, how should you think about it? Well, innovation is around an improvement of efficiency and delivering better customer value. For business-to-business innovation, McKinsey and Company taught us many years ago something called economic value to the customer. That is, your product either delivers the ability to generate more revenue, the ability to lower cost, or some combination of the two. And if it does not deliver them, your product has no value to the customer. So you need to be able to quantify how much more revenue the customer can generate, how much less it will cost to operate using your product, either operational expense, OPEX, or CAPEX, or both. And if you can't do that, your product has no value to the customer, and the customers won't buy it. It's pretty simple, but it's very clarifying, it's very dollarizing. So if you can dollarize this, then you say, okay, my EVC is X, and this is why a customer should buy it, and I can compare it with the competition, and I can calculate what their economic value to the customer is, and mine's better, and therefore the customer should buy it. So it's pretty clear for businesses. What about B2C? Well, consumers are trend conscious, we're social animals, we're tricky and fickle and so forth, but I've come down to the following three points. Consumers buy things because they save you time, they save you money, or they make you happy. And if it doesn't do one of the things, consumers won't buy it. So it's pretty simplifying. But if you can't explain why you're going to save the consumer time, money, or make them, you know, amuse them, then you're not likely to make the sale to consumers either. Okay, so let's talk for a moment about a company that we invested in, and a company where I served on the board of directors, a company called Siri. Siri was spun out of SRI International's $180 million research project by the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. This lasted over about 5 years. 25 universities and research organizations all combined together. And the idea was to bring the various piece parts of artificial intelligence into a single technology, and with that technology to create a battlefield agent or assistant that enabled commanders in battlefield theaters, Iraq and elsewhere, to call on resources logistically real time and to be able to assemble the right information to make decisions in real time. This had been a very costly, slow, expensive, uncertain process in the past, and the idea was to use artificial intelligence to make it easier. So they assembled piece parts of speech recognition, natural language, dialogue management, ontology models, inference engines, deduction engines, interfaces to various services and file types, and they assembled that all together and they deployed it. And within DoD, this was viewed as quite a great success, I think. So in 2008, a team of three people spun out of SRI saying, we think this can be commercialized and we think something interesting could come of it. And their vision was very interesting. They walked into my office one day and said, we would like to create a virtual personal assistant for the internet. At the time, they called it HAL. I said, HAL's not such a great idea because HAL's kind of evil. They said, well, he's back, but he's good this time. He's better this time. He's been to therapy. So we talked about this. And at first, they really didn't have any idea about how it was a great idea, it sounded great, but they didn't have any idea how they're going to make money with it. And they didn't have any idea about how they would convert users to habitual daily use. So they went back and they thought about it, and they came back the next time, and I was incredibly impressed because they had thought through all the feedback we gave them. They had great answers to all the questions. It was clear they're on a mission, and it was clear that they could figure things out and make it happen almost overnight. So we engaged, we became committed, invested, I joined the board. And at that point, they began, I think John Doerr talks about mercenaries and missionaries. This was definitely a missionary group. So from three people, it grew to 24 people over a 28-month period, mostly engineers. Those engineers submitted their code into the code check-in 15,000 times over a 24-month period. So if you can imagine writing that much code and checking it in that often, that was an amazing feat. And they also studied the customers. So once they actually had prototypes of the product, they brought in the customers, they had the customers sit down and use the product, and they would videotape them and they'd kind of watch over the shoulder to see how they interacted. And they took all the ways that customers messed up and fumbled, and they tried to, one by one, fix those. They put metrics onto everything. They measured, you know, what was the recognition rate, what was the, you know, at the speech level, at the natural language level, to what extent did we map it into the right domain, to what extent did we connect to the right service, to what extent did we pass the parameters correctly, to what extent did the consumer get a satisfactory answer. And so how did all of this come about? And along the way, they had started with a vision of thumb typing, and I persuaded them that really this was, in mobile context, it would be best used for speech recognition. We'd been investors in a company called Nuance Communications, which today is a leader in speech recognition. So the team, once again, figured it out, jumped on it, and literally by the next board meeting had implemented something called Lingo. With that, CEO Doug Kitlaus went to Verizon and persuaded the upper management at Verizon that this was something they had to have. It had to be on the home screen. And with that, a deal was consummated with Verizon. And we went to launch the product in the marketplace. I won't say too much about this because I'm under non-disclosure, but it is written in the press that Steve Jobs called, I think, 3 weeks later and engaged with the CEO. If you're interested, there's lots of blogs talking about this. And a fairly lengthy courtship over about 45 days. I mean, that's lengthy, I think, for Steve and for Apple. But today, Siri is part of Apple. I'm going to talk to you about the customer adoption model in a moment. But Siri and Apple have changed everybody's expectation. And it was, what I want to emphasize is, the initial product didn't have an adoption model. It wasn't based on speech recognition. It didn't have the web services it was connected to. The team iterated, you know, weekly, if not daily, on fleshing out the vision, figuring out the value proposition, watching how the customers behaved and interacted with this, and making changes, and rewriting the code, 15,000 check-ins. So today, it's part of our collective experience. It's hard to imagine the world without it. That's how quickly it moves. And a year after, people were in awe, shock and awe about it. Now they're dissatisfied that it's not perfect. So I guess that's success. Please.
Good question. So how do you even go with this? How do you really validate for yourself that this is something that solves a pain point out there? How do you, number one, ensure that this is a real pain point, sort of a vitamin versus a painkiller sort of idea?
Yeah.
And how do you know that this right here actually solves it? Because you can see lab experience, but it's oftentimes be very different what happens in the real world.
Right.
So how did you think about that, those two key questions?
So I want to go back to economic value to the customer and to does it save you time, save you money, make you happy, right? So from our point of view, we saw this plethora of APIs, application programming interfaces, becoming available. Some 6,000 are now available to e-commerce services on the internet. Well, how does any individual know how to get to them? How does any individual know what services to use? What if you could just express what you want to do and you had your personal assistant to the internet that knew where all the right services were, that was trusted with your information, trusted with your transactions, and could make those decisions or make those, is to assemble the information for you and allow you to make an assistant a decision, a transaction that you're in total control of? What if it could do that and you didn't have to go research the whole internet to get that done? So that just resonated with me and with our team, and we built faith pretty quickly. This team could do it, and in fact, they did. It's not perfect, but it's way better than anything else that existed at the time, and even to this day, I would argue. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. So, at the time, Siri looked at this, and one of the ways we said, how is it that we get people to use this? And Don Kitlaus came up with this slide. And he said, look, we're going to have to build trust and user engagement gradually. And this was around iterating, if you will, the product and market strategy. So at first, we would start with quick start of finding local things to do, finding local information. This would just be a useful tool. It would give you the weather. It would give you access to various services. Checking flight status, checking movie availability, checking a variety of things. Later, that we would personalize this and we would make it easy to remember. We'd put things on your calendar. We would allow you to send SMS texts, send emails, and so forth. Finally, we would make it social and shareable. You'd be able to send messages. Those would be branded with Siri. So this was the original vision. And finally, the way we would monetize is we would be a trusted intermediary by now, you would entrust us with your credit card information. We could intermediate transactions. You wanted to do impulse gift purchases and the like. We make it happen for you and just take a small fee on the way. So that was the original vision, and all of this came out of, you know, series of iterations of thinking about, okay, great technology, great idea, how do you monetize it? So another company I want to talk about is a new company in our portfolio, which I'm quite excited about. And the final chapter on this one is far from written. In fact, the company launched its product earlier this month. The product is what's called a cloud database system. The relational database management systems market, which I had the pleasure to be an early entrepreneur and a participant in, is today a $35 billion market. It's hard to believe, you know, that we started out and that we're all scrapping for individual, you know, customers, that this would ever be a market of this size. It's enormous. It is, along with operating systems, the largest single software marketplace in the world. That market is dominated today by Oracle, IBM, Microsoft, and SAP. And the incumbents have all the huge advantages that I showed you at the outset. So the idea of penetrating that is like, it seems like a theoretical impossibility, except all those architectures are tied to sort of big iron in a hierarchical, in a vertical structure, verticalized structure. It runs on very expensive computers sitting in a data center behind the firewall. And they are not architected to run well in the cloud architectures of today. So when you see the walls and walls of servers, that you see sort of rooms full of servers, they're all pizza box, one unit high, pizza box 14 to a rack or so, as far as the eye can see, all connected together with gigabit or 10 gigabit Ethernet links. And the database architectures of the past don't scale into this new architecture, which is much lower in cost, much more scalable. So the question is, how is it that you get to this new market? There is a class of companies that have arisen called NoSQL companies. They say, well, if you only throw out the structured query language, SQL, you can get to this new market, and therefore you can access, well, a little corner of the $35 billion market. The problem is it's a $0 billion corner of that market, and you'd really like to get to the whole thing. So this is a team out of Cambridge, Massachusetts, that we came across that saw the world differently, you know, jumped from fishbowl to fishbowl, and said, you know, what if you could take a whole new class of architecture, a class that we're calling emergent systems, and you base it on systems in nature that have very low-level communications from individual to individual. What if you could put hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands of them together? What if these interacted like, you know, flocks of birds or schools of fish? What if they all moved in unison, but no one was in charge? What if you could scale indefinitely? You could scale up, you could scale down, and you could continue to run. You run 7x24x365x10, 10 years at a time with no downtime. Isn't that what is needed on the internet? Isn't that the right vision? And so having spent some decades in this field, we dove in quickly and became convinced they could actually do this. And so in the last 8-9 months now, they started with a system running on 9 antiquated servers in a, you know, crufty little attic in the north end of Boston, in Cambridge. And they're running 7,000 transactions per second, and they were very proud of this. And I thought, well, you got to start somewhere. Today, we just launched the product. We ran a benchmark with 3.9 million transactions per second, demonstrating seamless ability to add new servers, take them down, operate, and be simply in not a database that's on the cloud, but a database that is of the cloud. So that this is the view for NewODB. It's kind of an entrepreneur that sees things differently, but as I say, the final chapter on this has not been written, so watch this space. Innovation is not just about product or about technology. This company is innovating their distribution as well. So Oracle sends out a very expensive sales organization, extracts very high prices, very high maintenance fees, and they are very adept at doing this and getting top dollar for their product. I commend them for that. But it's very expensive to do this, and if you're a young company, you have to think differently. Well, if you're a young company in the cloud, you can now think about how do you download. If you download the database, you can download it literally in 60 seconds. You can be up and running in literally, you know, in less than a minute. And you can scale out to any an arbitrary number of machines very quickly. And so we ran a demonstration of this for the press and others earlier this month, and it's kind of off to the races on this. So it's easy to install, easy to administer. It is a capacity on demand model. It's designed for the cloud architectures of the future. And it's designed to deliver database as a service. You don't even need the hardware. You want to run database? Fine. Just, you know, load this software, load it onto Amazon EC2, you're done. You know, you're up and going. It's in the cloud. You need more services? Add a server. You know, just right click, add a server, you're there. So this is jumping from fishbowl to fishbowl, seeing the world differently, looking at at Moore's Law, at the internet as delivery vehicles, and saying how could the world be different if we had an architecture that met the potential of the technology and solved customer pain points and problems. So
yeah. Have the incumbents reacted at all to this new form?
They've downloaded it. A number of them have downloaded it. So until we start stealing their business, and you know this is literally 2 weeks since we first showed it, so we have a lot of trials. We have I think 3,500 beta testers. We've had this up for like 8 months. So until we start stealing their customers, I don't imagine too much of a reaction. They have revenues to protect. They have accounts to protect. So, but I'm sure they're looking at this. I know they're looking at this. They have to be.
Well, remember, you, when you were at Ingress, were in the last generation.
Yep.
You were going against the hierarchical database systems that were the incumbents.
Tom was there. Tom was a customer, by the way. Thank you, Tom.
Was there anything that you learned in attacking the incumbents then that you can say, I can help my team that I'm investing in now anticipate some things that the incumbents might do?
Yeah.
I fought this battle.
Yeah, many things. And one of the things that we did was we held off on the announcement until we had adequate proof points around the technology. So. You may recall in the 1980s, companies were docked for the number of years in vapor, right? These product announcements for which there were no deliverables were called vaporware. And they used to track how many months or years, indeed, that companies had announced products but didn't really have a product, or worse, had a product and it just didn't work. So we didn't want to do that. So we were literally held off, I think, about six, seven months from the first thought of releasing a product, because it did work and it worked reasonably well, to where we had something that hit the proof points to the market. You know, the demonstration showed 24 servers, but we've run it on server, I think 50 plus servers, and we're working on scaling it to hundreds of servers. We'll get that done this year. So proof points around scalability, proof points around reliability and robustness, and proof points around customer success. So we announced Dassault Systèmes, which is makers of CATIA. Dassault has used the product over the last year, and they said, yes, we're kicking out Oracle, and we're standardizing on NuoDB. And we had AutoZone, which is a Fortune 300 company, say, yes, we've tested this. We've tested it for the last 6-8 months. And we are deploying it now to 4,000 AutoZone shops stations around the world. So it's a lot of fun to be back in the database arena. And I don't go back lightly because I'm batting 1,000 at this point. I really don't want to mess it up. Okay, so entrepreneurial agility. It's this last slide here. So entrepreneurial, and I'm right on time. Entrepreneurial agility allows faster evolution of your product value proposition, your distribution channels, and your customer relationships. And what's key for you who are thinking of becoming entrepreneurs is you need to say, we don't have to, time is the enemy. Entrepreneurial agility is our strength. we need to iterate faster. We need to listen more carefully to the customers. We need to focus our value proposition. We need to create the proof points. We need to land the accounts. We need to show the growth, convince investors that we're growing, that this is exciting, that they want to be part of it. And so, happily, the best entrepreneurial companies figure that out quickly and get it done. And when you have then the real value proposition, then things begin to have a life of their own, which is quite exciting. So listening is key to the customers, you know, to listening to the customers is key. Focus on where you can win. It's very important to decide which customers you can win and which you can't, and to, you know, focus all the time on the ones you can win and not waste your time on the ones you can't. Can't afford it. Demonstrate your value proposition and build the trust of the customers. You want customers that are so loyal that they become your advocates, that they actually become your sales force. And then you need to broaden your sales organization and figure out how many channels, what other people can you get that will take your product to market so that you get a much broader reach, bigger footprint than you are as an entrepreneurial company. So finally, entrepreneurs win by vision, focus, and innovation. The focus is, first, you've got to land and expand. You've got to land someplace. You've got to find a customer. You've got to prove the value proposition. You have to make your customer successful. And once you've done that, then the goal is, okay, fine, I've made you successful. What other applications are in your organization? Where else can, who else can you refer us to? Where is it that we can take this? The vision, you should start with a long-term goal. Start with a disruptive innovation. Start with a billion-dollar marketplace. But then it's down to, okay, what's the right sequence? You're crossing a chasm. Who are the, you know, early adopters? Who are the ones who are likely to adopt the technology? Focus on them first. And then finally, you have to start with a disruptive vision. Iteration is fine, but if you iterate from a bad idea, it doesn't help. If the idea is right, then you can fine-tune it. If the idea really is disruptive and it addresses a big market, then iteration is what gets you there. But I think the point I want to impress on you is iteration is a nice to have, but the need to have is you've got to start with a disruption or nothing else matters. So that's it. Mostly on time. I'd love to take your questions. And I think there's a workshop coming up. And thank you all for being here and listening.
Here, I got one for you.
Oh, hey, Dave.
No, I'm just curious. You know, you've seen the markets, you've seen the venture industry over a longer period of time than I have. It feels different now than when I started 13 years ago, yeah. And meaningfully different in ways that you know may or may not be good, but certainly different. And I'm curious what you're. You know, what do you think? You've seen the ups and downs of the market and the evolution of the industry. What do you think of it today?
Yeah. So this is kind of an inside baseball question for those of you. David is.
We've discussed it. So.
Okay, great. Is an esteemed colleague in the venture capital industry, and he is a partner of a great firm called August Capital. So one of our great trusted partners. So. What has changed? It's a bigger market to begin with. When venture capital industry started, this was a handful of families, family running family money in the 1970s. It institutionalized in the 1980s. Actually, my father played a role in that, interestingly, a topic for another time. It went from $100 million to $200 million of total capital coming into the market in the 1970s per year. To today, it is on the order of $20 billion a year, round figures. And it's been as high as, I think the peak year was as high as $100 billion in the in the 2000 period, back in the bubble. $20 billion seems to be about the right amount of money coming into the venture capital industry. The last 10 years has been hard. There have been fewer IPOs. I didn't show the statistics here, but there are about 50 IPOs all of last year. There were about 500 mergers and acquisitions all of last year. When you compare that to the 1,000 companies that get venture investment every year, 600 to 1,000 companies that get first investment from ventures, and many get follow-on investment subsequent to that, that's not a compelling outcome. And the LPs are saying, okay, where's the money? So the first point is the last decade has been one, first, where they're recovering from the internet bubble. Secondly, there was the crisis of 2008. Those two things were kind of witch's brew for venture capital returns because they quieted the public markets. We're a segment of the equity markets. The public equity markets are, you know, enormous. We're 1-2% of the public equity markets on a good day. So this is we're a very small sideshow to the main event, which is the public equity markets. The venture capital industry is highly cyclical. When the equity markets go up, people look for bargains and they say, okay, well, the growth companies and the exciting companies are these venture companies over here. And so they get bid through the roof as they did in the late 1990s and early 2000s. My personal opinion is venture capital cycles, and it cycles every 17 years or so. So my prediction is that on the order of 2016, 2017 is going to be a very good time to be in venture capital. There are a huge number of companies that are doing really well that would love to be part of the public market if only the valuations were right and if the rules were right and it wasn't so difficult. So long answer to a short question, but I predict better things for venture capital if you look historically at the cyclicality. I don't think the world has fundamentally changed. I just think this is a very cyclical business, and we're at the latter part of a 15, 17-year cycle.
Great. I've been in it 13. Thanks for nothing.
Yeah. Your timing's consummate. Just keep the faith. Keep the faith, Dave. Keep the faith. Yes. Hey, David.
I had a somewhat related question. Yeah. The first slide you put up, I thought was really interesting that, you know, there are 60,000 companies out there that are getting angel funded today, and 600 to 1,000 that are getting VC funded, and any given firm's maybe doing 10 of those a year.
Right.
How do you sort, you know, when there are 60,000 potential companies to look at and they're all contacting you, you know, what do you look for? Is there a filter? Is there certain industries you focus on? Like, how do you deal with it all?
Thanks, David. Mercifully, not all 60,000 call us. So that's so they sort. They do some of their own sorting. Secondarily, not all of the 60,000. So this is University of New Hampshire study, and they look at everything. They look at, you know, corner dry cleaners and local groceries, and they look at sort of you know, shops and mainstream. They're new business formations. This is all new business formation for which angel money is provided. So many of those are really don't start life as venture capital opportunities. The numbers are a little bit misleading. I'm just trying to give you a sense of the magnitude and the odds. How do you sort? Well, I'll tell you how we sort, and then Dave, I'm going to ask Dave to answer this too. We basically say there are too many of them, there are too few of us. We need to start with a thesis about what we think is going to happen, and therefore, based on that thesis, we have to have a prepared mind and go looking in specific places. And we want to be the ones doing the outreach. We want to be the ones making the connections. We want to be the ones who have the thesis and are sorting through a landscape, figuring out who we think the winners are in an important emerging space. So we want to be proactive rather than reactive. I think if you're reactive in this business, you're dead. I just don't think you do the good. There are firms with, you know, with Sandhill names and brands, you probably know them, that get a lot of press and PR. And for those firms, they see an awful lot of deal flow, and they have a lot of associates to process it. We don't. So we're very focused, very selective. We do outreach. We're proactive about it. David, what about you?
So interestingly, I'm going to tell you the exact opposite. It isn't to say we aren't proactive, but we describe ourselves as systematically opportunistic. We don't set themes. We don't look for particular sectors. We look for really great entrepreneurs who have thought about the world in a different way than we have, and hope we recognize it. Do you guys know who Cory Doctorow is? Cory's kind of a science fiction writer and a theorist, and a real character. And when I had started in the venture business, he was starting a very early social media company. I think it was called Open Cola at the time, and he was pitching me on the business. And basically, his idea was to say, look, you know, there are things for which I don't have time to engage in the universe, but others are already focused on it, and I can gain their expertise. And his example was that he was a Disney memorabilia collector. And he said that he would go on eBay. He could literally spend all day every day on eBay trying to find the right piece of Disney memorabilia. but he literally would have to be there all day, every day. But when he finally found that particular piece that he wanted, he was always bidding against the same people. And so he decided, actually, this is stupid. I don't need to do this at all. All I need to do is see what they're bidding on, and I know what I'm interested in. And so I will stop worrying about looking at all, and I will simply choose these filters, these human beings who are spending the time, and they'll be the answer. That's my universe, the venture world. I have spent, let's say you get 1,000 business plans or executive summaries in your inbox in a year. You know, the most we will fund is a couple per person. So 1,000 goes to 2. Maybe you spend time with 100 of them. So how do you sift through them? I will tell you, I read every single plan I get. I always do. But if it hasn't been sent by someone I know, I have never funded it. In 13 years, not a single one. Now, raises the interesting question, why am I reading them? guilt, Jewish guilt, that's why. It's my mother's fault, like all things. But great people introduce you to interesting opportunities and interesting ideas, and so my filter is great people, and I've had the good fortune to have that work astonishingly well once, and hopefully will continue to work well. But I agree, it's a very tricky thing. It's a very hard problem.
Yes, Stephanie. Yeah.
How do you think your background and your experiences, everything from being a programmer to McKinsey to Ingress, how do you think all of those experiences have helped shape your investment decisions and venture today?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I'll be interested in Dave's view on this as well. My personal view is you can't manage what you don't understand. And we invest early enough that if we don't understand the subject matter, then we're not able to recruit the right people. We're not able to fashion the right vision. We're not able to build and manage a team that can execute. We don't really know what to do. And so I'm actually, this wasn't started with the career wasn't started with this in mind. I was fortunate to do research here at Stanford right out of Harvard. And before they knew I couldn't program, I learned to program. So it was merciful of them. but having said that, I spent 6-7 years doing exactly that, and then building programs, hiring engineering teams, scaling them up, and so forth. And after that, this is kind of part of your DNA. I mean, you do something that long, it's part of who you are. So I think it's, if the one thing I said is, when you're building a career, you're building not just a portfolio of experiences, but you're building a sort of an intuition around the space. And it's that intuition that guides you via pattern matching, via having been there, seen it in different forms. And I think that is essential. The best investors that I see are the ones who really deeply understand a specific domain, understand a specific problem set, a specific customer set, and therefore when they see something that's really the disruptive innovation, they recognize it on the spot. And they're the ones that don't feel like they're taking a risk when they invest behind it. They don't feel like it's a risk because this is going to work. I know it. I've lived this. And everyone else doesn't know how to qualify things. And so it's a real advantage when you see the right idea, the right team, you can move quickly. So David, what about you?
Well, this is back to the, oh my God, I only have 13 years, I'm screwed. and the wrong 13 years. I was just at a board meeting and I had this conversation. We were having this conversation and we were talking about raising additional capital for the company. And what it would take, and we said, oh, the company has X, Y, and Z indicia of success, and so it's great, and someone made this comment, like, oh, the venture business, it's all about pattern matching, and so it'll be great, because there are all these patterns. And I said, yeah, it's true, it's fantastic that the venture business is all about pattern matching, the only problem is that every company's unique. And we all sort of laughed nervously because we knew that on the one hand, you're kind of looking for these things that remind you of the things that you should have funded, usually, not usually the ones you did. And then on the other hand, you acknowledge that no matter how similar they are, at some point it's going to be totally different. You go, I don't know what to do with that. So I had a phone conversation once with Dick Costolo, who now runs Twitter. At the time, he was running a company called Feedburner, and he had this great team, and I was a huge fan of his. And he was in Chicago, and I was chicken, and I didn't fund his company. And then a new team came in, and they pitched me, and I was excited about it, and I gave him a term sheet, and I called up Dick, and I said, hey, how are you? Just wanted to let you know I'm funding these other guys, and it's because of you. And he said, what do you mean? And I said, well, I was an idiot, and I didn't fund you guys, but these guys totally remind me of you, so I'm going to fund them. And Dick's answer was, what good is that for me, you know? And now I laugh about it, because it's like, come back and let me fund Twitter, you know? Yeah. But, you know, you can only do what you describe. And so, you know, I am forever envious of someone who has the history. First of all, the history of having built something, and then the history and track record of having been in the industry as long as you have, to have the ability to, as my partner Dave says, have a deeper lookup table. You know, I mean, it's good. It's a good thing to have.
Yes.
So, a lot of people talk about this word disruptive, and sure, you kind of insinuated, you know, tackling a really big market, tackling something that hasn't been done before, and the way that you inform those decisions are based on having a good track record of being in the industry. Maybe seeing some telltale signs of what has been successful in the past, or perhaps having built and run your own company before. But I want to hear from your own words, how do you identify from those thousands of proposals and executive summaries what can be disruptive, aside from intuition, and aside from what also are the other indicators, such as the long-term goals and a strong team, and having, you know, a good plan for your project using new technologies? What are those indicators?
Yeah. So it's a great question. I actually tried to touch on this, but it bears repeating and maybe elaborating. So to me, it's all about economics. I think at the end of the day, all of these decisions are driven by economics. And so I think the insights are about team and technology and market opportunity, what will work, but it's also understanding how is it that you're creating value for the customers. And so that notion of EVC, you know, like the first week at McKinsey they drilled it into was, this is economic value to the customer, and you need to be able to describe how this, you know, your company's product is different than all the other competitors, why it's better, why it offers more value to the customer. So to me, it comes down to, what are you doing for the customer? You know, what is it, how is the customer's business and different, you know, business and profits and life different and better if they use your product versus if they use something else? And if you look at things, to me, there are innovations which are features. We see this a lot. We see features masquerading as products, masquerading as companies, right? And the feature is nice and it's compelling. We see a lot of these, right? You say, oh, that's a great feature. You know, I really like the guy's great, you know, it's a great team, but that's a feature, that's not a product. And a company really has a place in the market. It has a role in the market where it serves a set of needs for its customers. And so for us, it's like, okay, is this a company, not a product, let alone a feature? Is this a team that can build the company? And what is the value proposition to the consumer? Because those incumbents are going to fight you tooth and nail. They're all Mike Tysons, you know, ready to deliver a, you know, crushing blow to the people, the upstarts that dare intrude upon their marketplace. So you need to be enough better. Actually, you know what? The way I really judge it is, if the competition gives their product away for free, will the customer still buy my product? Are we enough better that the customer would still take it? It's still in the customer's interest, even if the competition gives the product away, because you know what? They do. You know, they have the ability to cross-subsidize, and if they really want to put you out of business, they will simply take their profits elsewhere, you know, from another part of their customer interaction, and they'll discount to zero the product that you're competing against. This happens all the time in the marketplace. So my acid test is, will the customer still buy your product even if the competition gives it away for free? And I'm kind of to the point of view now, for obvious reasons, that, you know, I'm looking at it, it's like, if it's not really that compelling, life is too short, to fool around with, you know, Me Too products and undifferentiated value propositions, it's got to be significant. It has to be dramatically better. Or why waste time on it? The entrepreneurs shouldn't waste time, and I'm not interested. So
kind of my follow-up question to that is, you alluded to this point of having a need, at least when, you know, quantifying what this EVC is, right? Disruptive markets, to me, intuitively mean perhaps like not necessarily having a need in the first place. So, for example, I mean, let's use Facebook, right?
Yeah. Where's the need, right?
Right. Yeah, there wasn't a need at first.
Makes you happy though, right?
Sort sure.
of saves you time, saves you money, makes you happy. So for consumers, it's about, you know, we are social animals, and staying connected to other people is a fundamental part of our psyche. It's our psychological makeup. And so this was an easier and better and faster way to do that, and a way to do it scalably, and a way to do it with the system automating it and using the internet as a platform to manage fundamental human behaviors and to, I would argue, make us happy. I'm not sure it really does, but it keeps us busy anyway. So, yeah.
There was a need for Facebook. Women don't feel this need as deeply as men do. But when I was an undergraduate,
here it comes. here it comes.
I was looking for girls today, and it's basic biology. And I don't think women on Facebook is interesting as guys. And it was invented by a guy, right? And so the need is there. The need to find someone that you want to go out with, you're attracted to, connect with them in the way that they're not.
There you go. Okay.
Find it organized.
Reid Hoffman will say that all consumer businesses need to apply to one of the vice or a deadly sin or whatever. You know, that he views that if it's not applying to greed or lust or whatever, then it's not going to succeed.
Could I go back to your original question about disruption? Because I think it's a really fantastic question.
Yeah.
Here's how I think about it. I have seen a lot of products. There have been products on first experience that have taken my breath away. It's like, wow. It's either I didn't know I wanted that as much as I wanted, or it's amazing. And if you are in a category where you can create that experience with a prototype or with something that, think about the things that when you first experience them, it's like, wow, man, this is really great. That's disruption at the consumer level. And I think that At the enterprise level, the people who are running the visionary people who are running companies who want to be at the top of their industries love to win. And they will have that same experience. They see a relational database and they go, if I put this in, I'm going to be such a better bank than any of the other banks, and I'll be able to dominate my market. And the thrill of market domination, if you're a business leader, is akin to the thrill of some really cool, you know, like driving a sports car, whatever it is. And I remember when I met Bill Gates for the first time, and I thought, he epitomizes this. This guy loves his business. He would go to the whiteboard and was talking, driving 2x2 and talking about these products and how he's going to crush Lotus and all this. I'm going, this guy loves this business. And so I think that's it. I think true disruption, it emanates from something that is really, really, really compelling, and we have all felt those things every once in a while. Most products aren't. Most entrepreneurs aren't really. We cut the things that really click, maybe on 10 pictures.
I like that idea. The things that take your breath away when you first use them, the first time you use Google and you say, wow, that was fast. And it did a really complete search, and it really got everything I was looking for, and it ordered it in the right way and delivered it to me. That was a kind of an aha moment. So I think disruptive technologies are kind of, for their specific domains, they're kind of aha moments. They're things that you didn't think could be done, and now you see they can. And then suddenly, when you see they can, you just really interpret the world differently. And the great thing about us is that we're so plastic in our intelligence that we make that the new normal very quickly. And so the exciting thing for all of us is that we're very adaptable, and as the world progresses and evolves, we're going to change right along with it to where this is just commonplace, and then now I need a new disruption, you know, to make me happy again.
Thank you. So we're going to go ahead and move on to the workshop. Thank you.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.